Hello, my name is Octahedron, and I've been speed typing on and off for over 7 years now. In this video, we're going to talk about probably the most important factor to your improvement as a typist. So, if you're a typist looking to get faster, then listen closely. If you look for tips on how to type faster, then the most common piece of advice you will get, by far, will be to practice. Practice is definitely the most important part of improvement in typing, but to simply tell someone, practice more, is sort of selling it short. There are a lot of different factors to practice, and it's not as simple as just opening up your favorite typing website and typing words all day until you're fast. In this video, I'm going to explain in depth how you should practice in order to maximize your typing progress. The first thing I want to talk about is your foundational typing skill. What I mean by that is just your basic method of typing. Specifically, I think there are two really important things to consider and fix as early as possible when typing. First of all, make sure your accuracy is at least decent. If your accuracy is too low, you're going to develop serious bad habits over time. Your muscle memory can't distinguish whether the keys you're typing are correct or not, so if you always type at low accuracy, you're going to stay at low accuracy, and the faster you get, the deeper that low accuracy is going to be rooted in your typing, and the harder it will be to fix. What I suggest doing is slowing down to a speed where you're able to get at least 93% accuracy, and I personally always try to strive for at least 96 or 97%. On a good test, it should be even higher than that. While it can be painful to slow down, it's beneficial to your typing in the long run, and sometimes you'll be surprised by how fast you can type by just going slower. The next major foundational typing skill I would focus on is how many fingers you're using. Many people have become extremely accomplished typists despite having what I would consider to be strange typing methods, such as only using 2 or 3 fingers, index spacing, using caps lock instead of shift, the list goes on. However, if you're not already an accomplished typist, then I would highly recommend taking the time to learn to type with 9 or 10 fingers. It is also extremely important that you can type without looking at the keyboard. Personally, if you haven't already, I recommend learning the home row method using a website like Typing Club. However, let me make it clear that the standard home row method is not the end-all be-all. You can and absolutely should change things up to fit your own style. Some people like to incorporate one of their thumbs that they otherwise wouldn't be using to press certain keys, for example. And I personally think that the standard touch typing method suggestion that you should hit C with your middle finger is ridiculous, and I press it with my index finger instead. I would also say that if you are interested in learning an alternate keyboard layout, this should be the time that you do it. Overall, the standard home row method is a good tool to learn how to use all of your fingers and type without looking at the keyboard. Make use of that tool, but don't treat it as anything more than that. Soon, I will get into some helpful tips that you can actually apply instantly to your typing practice. But first, I want to mention some of the more psychological factors of typing practice, because I think they are equally important. For starters, learn not to compare yourself to others. The diversity we see in the typing community in terms of skill and speed of improvement is absolutely insane. Some people will go from 60 to 120 words per minute faster than others will go from 40 to 60. There are lots of reasons that people might be improving faster than you. Maybe you're making some kind of mistake. Maybe you aren't practicing as much, or maybe they have some other kind of advantage, like the fact that kids often seem to learn typing faster than adults for some reason. I'm not an expert on why some people will improve faster than others, but I do know this. As with many other things in life, you cannot get bogged down comparing yourself to others. Don't let it get to you, just keep practicing. The next psychological factor I want to talk about is bad days. Once again, I'm not an expert, but I can tell you what I do about bad days. I personally tell myself that bad days do not exist. Almost every time, at least for me, as long as there isn't some obvious major physical or mental issue that's going to affect my typing, a simple 30 to 60 minute break can work miracles and give you much better typing results. This also kind of ties into my final point on the psychological aspect, which is that you shouldn't get discouraged by your bad tests. I see lots of people in the typing community get sad because they keep choking PBs, or because they can't even get within 5 or 10 words per minute of their personal best, but the thing is, that's just pretty much normal. In fact, I would say that if I was managing to match my PB but then choking at the end of a test, then I got pretty close to getting a new PB, and I would be pretty excited. As someone who's been typing for so long now, I can tell you that when you hit big walls in your typing improvement, getting within 5 or 10 words per minute of your PB can sometimes feel like an absolute blessing. I would say that if you're getting within 5 words per minute of your PB consistently, you should be getting excited because you probably have the ability to get a new PB within the next few days. And do not forget this, you are never at your limit. Ever. You will not reach your limit. You might think you have an idea what your limit is, you don't. I thought I knew what my limit was when I finally typed 140 words per minute 3 years ago. And then I thought I knew again when I hit 150, and then when I hit 160. And that's about when I realized I have no idea what my limit is. The only way to find out is to keep pushing. Now that we've gone over your foundational typing skills and your typing mindset, we can actually get into more specific details about your typing, which I think will be the most immediately beneficial part of this video for you. First, let's talk about what I think is the most important thing of all to take your practice to the next level. Take the word practice out of your vocabulary and throw it in the garbage, because in its place, we're going to put this: deliberate practice. Real practice is deliberate practice. So what does deliberate practice look like? Deliberate practice looks like convincing yourself that every single test has a chance to be your next personal best. Deliberate practice looks like keeping track of your progress over time to see how far you've come. Deliberate practice looks like taking a moment to step back and think about how you could be typing better, or why you choked the last test, or what skills you need to work on the most. This is one of the keys to typing improvement. Spend less time aimlessly typing and more time actively trying to type better. Typing is repetitive, so we let ourselves filter out the details, we just grind and let our mind wander instead of focusing on the words, restart every time we make a mistake, except that we probably aren't getting a new personal best today. Don't do that. Stay focused. Every moment of your practice that isn't deliberate is a time where you aren't getting the fullest potential out of it. But deliberate practice isn't just about those things either. Deliberate practice has two sides. Deliberate practice also means only practicing when you think you can do well and when you're actually enjoying it. It means stopping or taking a break after only 30 minutes because your hands need a rest, and it means not forcing yourself to type when you don't want to. If this concept of deliberate practice sounds alien to you, you could be getting so much more out of your practice. Okay, that was the big one. That was the climax of the video. That was the main takeaway. But there's still more specific things that I'm going to go into. First of all, I want to talk about diversity of practice and mixing things up. If you only want to practice one mode, that's cool, but it's also not what I would consider being a good typist. In order to be a good typist, you need to practice lots of different modes and skills. That means you should include harder modes in your training, like quotes. In fact, I would argue that the modes you find hardest should be the ones you train the most. Monkeytype allows you to practice words that you missed or type slowly after you take a test. I think that doing this is extremely important to getting good practice, as well as retrying hard quotes that you didn't do good on the first time. When it comes to modes like gibberish and ASCII on Monkeytype, which are hard but not very practical, I think it's up to you how diverse you want your typing skills to be. Personally, I train these modes occasionally, but it's not a part of my regular practice. When it comes to mixing things up, there are really two different things that I mean. The first is that you should try different modes and settings that you aren't used to. Sometimes, when typing becomes monotonous, it's important that we switch things up to keep ourselves interested and motivated. Sometimes, though it's not super common, changing seemingly unimportant things up a little bit can bring a big benefit to your speed. If you're using Monkeytype, then doing things like enabling or disabling live words per minute or your timer display or adding a pace caret can help a lot. If you're not using Monkeytype, then maybe you could try out using a different website for a little bit and then go back to your old one. Now, to be clear, changing settings around is pretty speculative and might be completely placebo. Changing to different modes and trying out different typing sites, however, is in my experience clearly beneficial. Sometimes all you need to get a new Monkeytype 60 seconds PB is to practice some quotes on TypeRacer. It might sound counterintuitive, but it's true. Now, for the other meaning of mixing things up, I first want to explain two other concepts. The first concept is your rhythm when you type. You might not think about it at all, but rhythm is an important part of typing. You should speed up on easy words to take advantage of them, and slow down on hard words to avoid mistakes. When you make mistakes, it messes up your rhythm, and oftentimes regaining your rhythm is more of a detriment to your speed than the actual mistake itself. The second concept is one that I don't have a specific name for, although you could argue that it's just another part of rhythm, and it has to do with how you use bursts of speed during a typing test. This mostly applies to tests similar to 60 seconds on monkeytype. To give an example of it, when I'm trying to get a personal best on 60 seconds, I will try to go really fast at the beginning of the test, use that momentum to maintain a good speed through the middle, and then at the end I will try to burst again to squeeze out any extra words per minute I can get. This method is risky and takes lots of energy, which is why I only use it when I'm trying to get a PB, on a day where I'm already feeling confident. When I'm actually practicing, I try to burst at the beginning to get myself started and then just be consistent and hold it through the rest of the test. Anyway, this concept of managing your bursts of speeds is the other thing that I think you should mix up. Sometimes you might have better results by just trying to maintain a consistent speed throughout the whole test, other times you might have better results by just trying to burst for the whole test. Typing is extremely subjective, and that's why mixing things up is important. Last but not least, I want to mention that you should occasionally just take breaks when you're doing a typing session to check yourself. Most importantly, take a moment every once in a while to make sure that you aren't pressing the keys any harder than you need to, and check your posture. Make sure that you're pushing yourself, but not too hard. Check that you aren't restarting your test too much, and check that you're applying the things you learned from this video. Alright guys, that just about wraps it up for the video. On the screen, I'll be putting a list of people who I want to say thank you to for helping me make this video. I'm almost done editing the video now, and I can comfortably say that this was easily the hardest video I've ever made, so if you enjoyed it, I would definitely appreciate if you liked the video and subscribed. But more importantly, I want you to share this video with anyone you come across who is asking for typing advice.